so I can see you. Just so proud of what you're doing. Thank you for your friendship. Thank you for your encouragement. And really a real blessing to see. And I just want to say also, what you're creating is amazing. And what God might do here is incredible. And just as Pastor Errol was sharing earlier, he shared that this building used to be one in which young men and women were trained to make a difference in the world. And I believe there's something about you as a church where young men and women will come through your church as a community, whether it's in this building or another, and be trained to make a difference in the world around them. So I want to say who you are really matters. And Birmingham will be different as a result of your presence as a church here. So God bless you this morning. The next thing I'd love to do before we dive into God's I'm really passionate about and invite you to do something really important. And that is, if you're not already a personal member of the Evangelical Alliance, I want to invite you to become one. We've seen the video. Let me tell you a little bit more about. You might ask, what's an evangelical? Well, an evangelical is a good news person in a bad news world. Evangelical comes from the Greek word evangel, which means good news. Well, what else? Well, evangelicals are people of the Bible. We don't change the word of God to accommodate our culture. We want to see our culture transformed with the word of God. Secondly, we're people of Jesus. We believe that his life and his death and his resurrection was the most important moment in the whole of human history. That he's our God, but he can also be our friend. Thirdly, we're people of conversion. You don't become a Christian by accident or being born into a Christian family. Become a Christian when you make a decision to follow Jesus and you get down on your knees and you surrender your life to him. So we believe that that decision is the most important decision anyone can ever make. Fourthly, we're people of activism. We want to see the world become more like the kingdom. That's why it was evangelicals who were at the forefront of the abolition of the slave trade. More recently, that's looked like street pastors, Christians against poverty, food banks, whatever we can do to see hope comes to the hopeless in our world. And who we are as the Evangelical Alliance, we're an alliance of evangelicals. We believe that it's better to be together. Jesus' prayer in John 17 is that his church might be one. So what we do is the EA is we gather evangelicals from across every denomination, story and background. And we've existed since 1846 to do two really simple things. The first is we want to see every single person in the United Kingdom come to know Jesus, their Lord and Saviour. So we equip and we inspire and we unite the church around that. And the second thing we do is we speak up at the highest levels of government on issues that really matter to Christians. Why? Because the church is amazing. The Church of Jesus Christ is on the move and doing incredible things for communities in this nation. So we need to tell the government the story of what the Bridge Church and others are doing across the nation. But secondly, we speak up on really important issues like free speech. Why? Because it shouldn't be a hate crime to declare that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. One example of that, there was a bill going through Parliament a few years ago. That would have enabled Ofsted to come into every Sunday school and youth group in the country and essentially vet what was being said. We thought that sounded more like North Korea or Saudi Arabia, governmental control of private religion. So we spoke up on behalf of Christians. And I'm delighted to say that as a result of our intervention, that bill has been kicked into touch for the time being. Isn't that good news? But here's where we need your help. Because the size of our voice depends on the strength of our membership. And when the government asks us how many members do you have, we need to give a number. And we are 600 organisations, 3,000 churches, and 22,000 individuals at the moment. But individual membership has become increasingly important because that's the number the government asks for. And our dream over the next 10 years is to get to 22,000 to 50,000. Why 50,000? Because 50,000 is about the size of the membership of the Liberal Democrats. Bear with me. We are not a political party. We're not politically affiliated. We speak on behalf of Christians. But what I want to share with you is that our dream to get to 50,000 really matters because it means that when a new prime minister comes in, they knock on our door rather than the other way around. So would you help us today get to 50,000? If you're able to do so, I'll give you a little form. I've got a little table in the foyer. I'll give you a little form. You can fill in your details. It also costs just £3 a month. If you're part of a couple, you can tick the both of you. It's still £3 a month. If your spouse isn't here, tick the box anyway and tell them later. As a thank you for joining us today, if you're able to join us, we'd love to give you a few things. First of all, love to give you, if you're able to join us, a copy of my book on friendship. I'm about to talk about friendship. It's called The Best of Friends. I had a terrible pandemic. I was really discouraged and disappointed and bereaved. And two things got me through, faith and friendship. I became captivated by the power of friendship. I saw the challenges we face in our world around friendship. So I wrote a book on how Jesus is the model of how we should be friends with those around us. So we'd love to give you a copy of that for free. Second thing I'd love to give you, if you join us today, is this. It's called Speak Up. It tells your rights and responsibilities when sharing your faith in the workplace and in the community. There's loads of people who say you can't share your faith at work. You can. You just can't abuse a position of responsibility over an employee. Loads of people say you can't wear a cross at work. You can. You just can't wear a life-size one because it's a health and safety hazard. So I'd love to share a copy of that with you. And finally, for some of you, this might swing the deal. If you're able to join us today, I'd love to give you an Evangelical Lines key ring. I know. It's that good. On the end of it, it's got one of those detachable pound coins, which means next time you go to the supermarket and you need a trolley, a pound coin for your trolley, you will thank Jesus the day you joined the Evangelical Alliance. Also, would you do me a favour? Every time you use this or look at your keys, would you pray for us? Because we're desperate to see change in this nation. We're also desperate that we speak really clearly to government about what Christians are really about and defend our rights to be able to share our faith in this nation. Final thing I'd love to share with you is, by the way, if you're not ready to join us, I'll do this for a fiver. Normally $10.99 for you because I like you and I live in Birmingham, a fiver. And secondly, I also wrote a book on how you share your faith with your friends. One of the things we're going to be exploring this morning is praying for your friends who don't yet know Jesus to come to faith. This book I've written so that people might be equipped and inspired to be able to share their faith and their story of faith with their friends. That's also five. Would love you to share it with that with you today. Let's pray, shall we? Let's give thanks to God that he's on the move, that Jesus is alive, the kingdom is coming, church is growing. But let's also pray that today God would speak to us. So I just invite you in your heart this morning, would you pray a really simple prayer and say, Father, would you please speak to me today? Father, would you please speak to me today? In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as I said, I have the joy of living just around the corner in Birmingham, and my travel, the Evangelical Lines offices are in London. So what I often do, as I will do this week, I will travel down on a Wednesday or a Tuesday morning down to London on a train and then stay overnight somewhere in London, then come back the following day. But because I'm quite cheap, I've refused to pay for a hotel. So I've got a load of friends who I stay with on a Tuesday or a Wednesday night. And so I don't outstay my welcome anywhere. I'll often kind of rotate those friends where I stay. And last year, I was staying with a friend of mine who I know from university. It's one of those relationships, I don't know whether you have these, where I know him far better than I know his wife. In fact, I'd only met his wife a couple of times. And so with his wife, I'm in the awkward territory. I don't know if you know this territory. We're in the awkward territory where you're somewhere between a handshake and a hug. Do you know what I'm talking about? And I'm somewhere in that. And so as I'm staying at their house, I decide that to thank her, I just wanted to thank her. It was time to go from handshake to hug. And so I'm sat in the living room with his kids. He's sat in the kitchen making dinner. And she comes down the stairs. And I decide to make sure in no uncertain terms, we've gone beyond handshake, it's time for a hug. So I approach her with my arms wide open. And I embrace her. And I say, thank you so much for letting me stay. And it's fair to say in this moment, her enthusiasm for this was a lot less than mine. And then there's this terrible moment where we step back and we look at each other. And I'm cringing just thinking about it. The blood drains from my face when I realise that the woman I've just hugged is not the wife of my friend. It's the friend of the wife of my friend who I didn't recognise, who was over for a play date with my friend's kids. And we did this really British thing where we looked at each other and we said with our eyes, we will never speak of this again. Just because we have proximity doesn't mean we have intimacy. Just because we have 1,000 connections on Facebook doesn't mean we have any true friends who we can call when the storm has hit the shores of our life. Just because we're in the house of the Lord doesn't mean we have a friendship with him. And I believe that we are living in relational poverty at the moment with each other and often with the Lord. But fortunately, the Bible has some beautiful words to say about this. So if you've got a Bible, would love you to turn with me to John chapter 15. And I'm going to read some wonderful words that Jesus speaks about the nature of true relationship with him and with others. Jesus says this, John chapter 15 from verse 5. Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, so that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name, my Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. We were created for connection with God and to love one another. And yet, the picture that's painted across the UK at the moment is anything but that. Do you know, somewhere between 1 in 5 and 1 in 3 men say they have no close friends. It's not much better for women. 40% of 16 to 24-year-olds, by the way, the most connected generation in history, say they always or often feel lonely. How on earth have we reached a state in the UK at the moment where we've got a minister in government whose responsibility is loneliness? The World Health Organization just 3 weeks ago said that loneliness is a global pressing health concern. And yet we were created for friendship, for relationship. And we need friends. We've got music and movies on demand. We've got the world in the palm of our hand. We've got fun trips, internships, play scripts and hair snips. Film clips, fish and chips at the touch of our thumb tips. Need to lead or breed or feed your cat? Well, it turns out there's an app for that. But we need friends. We've got computers for a fiver. Cars without a driver. We've got louder, further, faster, more. A bigger network than ever before. But we need friends. And friends are amazing. See, friendship is atomic. From the nursing home to the coffee shop, from the boardroom to the playground. It's relational connections that make the world go round. See, we were created to know and be known. It's better to eat kebabs with friends than salad on your own. And yet we trace in populous places, with strangers in rooms of familiar faces. We crave deeper meaningfuls but experience anonymity. We dance superficially around the promise of proximity, and we need friends. And quantity is no substitute for quality. We need 5G, HD, 24 carat friends. Lifelong, fight strong, tag along, forgive all wrong friends. Friends to talk through our problems personal. Friends to call when the cancer's terminal. When it hasn't been your day, your week, your month, your year, you just remember what your old pal said. We get by with a little help from our friends. And look to the one who made friendship possible, whose nail-pierced hands bridged a chasm uncrossable. His scandalous invitation follows the most glorious of amends. There is no greater love than they that lay their life down for their friends. So, celebrate with me the ship most worth sailing, and follow the example of the friend unfailing. May we raise our game and drop our cover, invest our energies in one another. May we still be there when the rain starts to fall, and accept the most important friend request of all, because we need friends. And what I believe this beautiful passage of scripture tells us and gives us is 3 lessons for our friendship today that we desperately need. And the first is, if we can have the next slide up, please, with Jesus on the cross. is that great friendship is sacrificial. Do you know, just about the most powerful cultural story in our world today, it's what's called expressive individualism. You might not know it as that, but I bet you know it by its mantras. Its mantras are things like, you do you, be your authentic self. Meaning and truth are found within. Follow your heart. Be true to your own desires. The story of our culture tells us that we discover, create, or choose our identity from what's inside us and express that in the world. David Foster Wallace comments that everything in my own immediate experience supports my deep belief that I am the absolute center of the universe. We live in a world that tells you to promote yourself, to look after yourself first, look after number one. And yet Jesus says this is true friendship. There is no greater love than they that lay their life down for their friends. Maybe the reason we are lonely and fractured in our world is because we've lost the heart and the art of preferring others' needs above our own. And for some of us, that might mean dropping everything for a friend who's in desperate need at the moment. For some of us, that might mean avoiding the need to be right all the time on social media. For some of us, that might mean spending time with people who are different from us. But my urge to you this morning is to reflect the friendship of Jesus to a world that desperately needs it by laying down our lives for our friends. The person I've seen most recently this in is my mum. As I mentioned, I had a terrible pandemic that friendship got me through, and faith in Jesus. One of the reasons the pandemic was so bad for me is that my first book came out in March 2020, which was the week all the bookshops closed. I've never been so discouraged or disappointed. You build up for something so long and then that happens. I was like, no. But then something far more tragic happens. My mum had been battling with cancer for about 6 months. And we found out in the first few weeks of the pandemic that my mum's cancer was terminal. So I spent the first few weeks of the pandemic sat at the end of my mum's driveway with my then 2-year-old, watching her physically deteriorate. But yeah, this was a woman who had given her life to Jesus at a young age. She'd chosen to follow him. And it was like that throughout her life, as she devoted her life to Jesus, she was making investments in a spiritual bank account. And that in her moments as she approached death, was taking withdrawals from that dividends from that spiritual bank account. So physically, she was wasting away, yet inwardly, spiritually, I saw her never so strong. And then she did something amazing. In a moment when she had every right to just think about herself, she got her iPad out one afternoon and did something I recommend we all do if we know we're going to be with Jesus soon. And she recorded a message to be played at her funeral. She always wanted the last word, did my mum. She records this message that tells those who were to be at her funeral that the faith she had in Jesus was giving her forgiveness for her past, God with her in her present of agony, and absolute assurance and hope for the future. And she went to be with Jesus on the 8th of June 2020. And we weren't able to have a physical funeral because of the restrictions that were still in place. So we had a funeral on Zoom, and like 300 screens turned up. It was absolutely amazing. And we got to play my mum's message. She got to preach at her own funeral. And then because I'm an evangelist, and she wasn't around to stop me, I had the last word. And I gave people the opportunity who were there, who were watching my mum's story, to be able to choose to follow Jesus for themselves. And as we clicked leave at the end of the Zoom meeting, I turned my phone on. And there was a message from one of my mum's friends who she'd prayed for many years to meet Jesus. That simply said this: Phil, I prayed that prayer with you. I believe Jesus died for me. Is that amazing? But why does that happen? Because a woman knows what sacrificial friendship is. And was true to the words of Jesus that there is no greater love than they that lay their life down for their friends. So today, may we be encouraged to follow the friendship of Jesus. These words that were spoken days before he went to go to the cross to die for the sins of the world. And may we reflect that as we lay down our lives for those around us. Because great friendship is sacrificial. Secondly, Great friendship is intentional. Jesus said in verse 16, "You didn't choose me, but I chose you." And that's really interesting because that's not what normally happens with disciples and rabbis. Normally what would happen with disciples and rabbis is that disciples would choose rabbis. Normally, learned students would find a rabbi they wanted to be like. And they'd say, "Can I learn from you? Can I spend time with you? Can I follow you around and learn to be your apprentice?" But Jesus is intentional. Jesus flips the norm. He proactively chooses his followers. He chooses 12 men to change the world with. Then what's also interesting with Jesus is that not only does he choose 12, but he also has an inner circle of three. He chooses Peter, James, and John. There's some awkward moments in the Gospels, right? Where Jesus says to 9 of his disciples, "You wait there. Peter, James, and John, you come with me." Do you know who I feel really sorry for? Andrew. Do you know why? Because Andrew's Peter's brother. Why doesn't he get to go? James and John are brothers. They get to go with Jesus. Peter gets to come. Andrew's like, "Why can't I come?" Do you know what's even worse? It was Andrew who introduced Peter to Jesus. But Jesus, for some reason, he's really intentional. Do you know why I think this is? Because in his humanity, we read in Philippians that Jesus empties himself. By the beginning of this passage, Jesus says, "I'm the vine and you're the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you'll bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing." Do you know, too many of my friends are prioritizing their golf swing or their career or their house extension or their addiction to their smartphone over their relationship with Jesus. This friendship really does mean everything. And do you know what? If you're not a Christian today, if you've never had a moment where you've accepted God as your friend, you can. And that is the greatest news in the universe. It means forgiveness for our past, God with us today, and hope for the future. And the reason that Jesus says, "I will lay my life down for his friends," is that he makes that possible for us by dying and rising again and inviting us to friendship with him. This really matters. Jesus is intentional with us, and that friendship changes everything for us. And doesn't make our life a bit better? I think sometimes, especially in the West, we can become convinced that Jesus somehow makes our life a bit better. It doesn't, it changes everything. I've got a few friends who don't yet know Jesus who I'm praying for to become Christians. One of those is a mate called Dave. We've all got a mate called Dave, haven't we? And my mate Dave, who lives in Stourbridge, just down the road, speaks a bit like this. I've been praying for Dave to come to faith for about 20 years. And I had lots of conversations about faith with Dave. Can I tell you my favourite? My favourite was where his life was a bit of a mess. So we're having a conversation and he says, "Phil, my life's such a mess. What shall I do?" And so I'm not very pastoral and I didn't really have any wisdom for him. So I said, "Dave, your life is a bit of a mess." I said, "The only thing you can do is give your life to Jesus and let him sort it out." Do you know what he said? He thought for a minute. And then he said, "What's the second best option?" Here's the deal today. If you know Jesus, it doesn't matter what the other challenges are in your life, you are living in the best option for your life. And you know what? If you don't know Jesus this morning, it doesn't matter how much money you have, how well your career's going, how great your family's going, how wonderful your relationships are, you are living in the second best option for your life. And a couple of years ago, I was visiting Dave. He lives up in Newcastle now. He's abandoned the West Midlands. I can't imagine why. What a joker. Anyway, so I'm visiting Dave, and I'm preaching in a church on a Sunday night. So I text him in the week and say, "Dave, can I stay with you on the Saturday night? Because Newcastle's a long way, before I preach in the church on a Sunday night." And he texts back and says, "Yeah, that'll be great," because he obviously texts him from me. And then he said, "Would you like to come to church with me on the Sunday morning?" I text back, "Dave, I'm confused. Normally it's the Christian who invites the non-Christian to church." This is absolutely true. What he texts back was, he says, "Yeah, but there's a girl I like." I thought, whatever it takes to get Dave to church, I don't mind. So we turn up at his church, and it was nowhere near as cool or as enthusiastic as your church. The pews were a sea of grey hair. The first couple of songs I didn't know, which was really strange because I'm like a professional Christian. But I don't know if you've noticed, I'm quite an exuberant worshipper. And the third song came on, if we can have the next slide up, please. And it was Amazing Grace. Anyone else love Amazing Grace? Love Amazing Grace. So I sang it with great enthusiasm. I flung my arms in the air and went, "Amazing Grace!" And I was so loud that the people in the pews below, I was in the balcony, turned around to see what the racket was coming from upstairs. If I'm honest, a little bit of sinful selfish pride swelled up in me. Anyway, a couple of weeks later, Dave and I are on the phone. And he says, Phil, went back to that church you went to. They're still talking about your singing. Anyway, so because I've been trying to talk to Dave about Jesus for a number of years, I said, Dave, can I tell you why I sang like that? He goes, go on then. I said, the thing is, Dave, Jesus doesn't just make your life a bit better. He changes everything. Like for me, it's amazing grace. Like I once was dead, but now I'm alive. Once was blind, but now I see. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I said, Dave, do you get it? He goes, not really. So in my exasperation, I decided to rewrite Amazing Grace. It's how you might sing it if Jesus made your life a bit better. And it goes like this. Another next slide. Average grace. How bland's the sound. That slightly improved my life. I went to church and I liked the songs and now I have to be nice. It's not average grace. It's amazing grace. It's amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Friendship with Jesus changes everything. Let us never be lulled into the sense of security that it somehow slightly upgrades our life like some kind of broadband deal. Knowing Jesus really means everything. It's a difference between life and death, hopelessness and hope, darkness and light. And God's offer is that we might be friends with him. Isn't that amazing? Finally, friendship with Jesus is invitational. Sacrificial. It's intentional. But it's also invitational. As God extends the invitation of friendship to us, he invites us to extend that friendship to a world that is disconnected from its creator. And through that, we become better friends. Verse 16, Jesus says this. You didn't choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. And we bear fruit in so many ways. In becoming more like Jesus. In all those things that are written on your beautiful values at the back of your church. Prayer, Bible study, community, empowerment, responsibility, excellence, service, generosity, worship and discipleship. We bear fruit through all those things. But there's one in the middle where we also bear fruit. That's through evangelism. That's through being good news people in a bad news world. And you know, one of my jobs at the Evangelical Alliance is I'm a missiologist. I study how people come to faith. And you know, most people come to faith not through an evangelist like me or even a pastor like Pastor Errol. Most people come to faith, the most important human connection is a friend. It's a friend. Errol and I have a mutual friend called Adam who we were at school with together. He was nowhere with God when we were at school. His dad was in and out of prison. He was into drugs, drink, girls, the lot. But when he was 21, he had an encounter with Jesus that changed his life. But I was his friend as a teenager. I just kept inviting him to stuff. I kept praying for him. And by the grace of God, he turned 41 this week. He's been following Jesus for the last 20 years and his life is completely different. God uses us, partners with us to bring life to the dead. It's through a friend. Your life might be the only Bible your friends ever read. Your invitation to church might be the only one they ever receive. So in this, as you focus in this month around prayer, there is such a connection between prayer and evangelism. And I want to urge you with all the things that you pray for, pray for the world. Goodness me, the world needs prayer at the moment. Pray for the church. The church needs prayer at the moment. Pray for the sick. Pray for those with responsibility. But also, please pray for your friends who don't yet know Jesus. If you haven't got a list yet of a few friends of yours who don't yet know Jesus, family members who are far from God, I want to urge you to write a list down. Start praying for them. Do you know, I think we're in a vacuum of hope at the moment. The Collins Dictionary Words of the Year for 2022 was perma-crisis, which refers to an extended period of instability and insecurity, especially one resulting from a series of catastrophic events. We've lurched from a global pandemic to a cost-of-living crisis, the threat of World War III, death of a monarch, political turmoil, ecological and economic meltdown. And the world is feeling it. And as I talk to my friends at the moment, they've never been more open to the gospel. Never been more open to an invitation to a Christmas service. Never been more open to an invitation to church. A friend of mine did some research recently among students. Thousands of students across the UK. And they asked them, if you were invited to church by a Christian friend, would you come? 74% said yes. Don't say someone else is no for them. Pray for our friends and invite them to church. Because it really is a matter of life and death. It's not average grace, it's amazing grace. Let me give you an example from my life early this year of how I think that God uses us and partners with us to be a non-anxious presence in an anxious world. And that is, I've got a mate called John also who was at school with Errol and I. And John reached out to me a number of years ago. His life was in a really challenging place. And God's rebuilt his life over those years. And early this year, he got married. I had the privilege actually of being best man at that wedding. But in April this year, he texts me out of the blue. And if we can have the next slide, please. The text said this: got any time over weekend? Need a word with the top dog big man if you can help, pal. If your friends ask you, they need a word with the top dog big man, they're asking you to pray for them. Just a little bit of translation there. And so, as you can see, I'm a classy guy, so I took him for breakfast at Wetherspoons. Other pubs are available. And we sit and have breakfast together. And as we're talking, he tells me a terrible story. He tells me he had a phone call from his brother that week. And that his brother had called him to say that he had a suspected brain tumour. He had 3 kids, 1 on the way. And he called John to say, would he look after his kids when he died? So I'm like, what'd you do? I didn't know what to say. So I said, we should pray, shouldn't we? And he's like, what now? I said, yeah. He's not a Christian. We sat in the middle of this pub. It's like 9:30 in the morning, people drinking beer and all sorts. So I said, we should pray. So we do. And we continue to pray for his brother as a family. Text him a couple of days later and say, any news? He says, no. Can I have the next slide up, please? On the Tuesday, he says this: no brain tumour. Thanks for your work, pal. I told him that it wasn't anything to do with me, but the God that I know and I believed in, the God who's my friend. Do you know what's absolutely bonkers? John's still not a Christian. What has God got to do? Anyway, one day he might be. And I will not stop praying until he does. But here's what I believe. We as followers of Jesus are bearers of hope. And hope has a name, and his name is Jesus. And we bring our humble selves before God, partner with God in the world, pray for our friends to come to faith. And by the grace of God, so often, in a hopeless world, people reach out to hope. But we get to play a part in that journey. So I want to urge you to be those who pray for your friends. Carry that hope to a world that so desperately needs it, and be a non-anxious presence in a world drowning in anxiety. Verse 7 of the passage, Jesus says, whatever you ask in my name, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Verse 8, this is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit. There's a link between what we ask and the bearing of fruit. May we bear it well. So God bless you as a church. Thank you for the joy of worshiping with you today. May God be glorified. And may we be the best of friends to a world that needs it. May we be sacrificial, intentional, and invitational. Let's pray, shall we? And I just invite you in your heart, wherever you're at, just invite you in your heart to ask the Spirit of God to delete and remove that which I've said which has been unhelpful, but to burn on your heart and to remember and reflect on, chew on that which the Lord has said to you this morning. And for some of us, that might mean healing from where friends have hurt us. For some of us, that might mean choosing afresh to accept God's offer of friendship for us Some of us might be far from God. But we need to know that God's invitation today is to become friends with the creator of the universe. And if that's you, I just invite you in your heart to say sorry for where you've got it wrong. To choose to follow Jesus, even though you might not have it all together. And may you know that because of his death on the cross and his resurrection, you can be friends with the living God. And finally, for some of us today, as I talked about John and Dave, you know in your life you have people who don't yet know the King who loved them to die for them. The friend of sinners. And I just invite you in your heart to bring those people to the Lord in prayer this morning. Picture them in your mind's eye. Carry them to the cross. And also, would you commit to praying for them in the days ahead? We don't become friends with people to convert them. We're friends with people because we're made in the image of the relational God. And we are good news people in a bad news world. So, Father, would you continue to speak? Would you continue to minister to us? And may the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen.
Oh, and my, that you were mindful of me, that you hear me when I call. Is it true that you were thinking of me, that you love me? It's amazing, 'cause I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I choose to be. I am a friend. I want to be. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I? Who am I that you were mindful of me? That you hear me when I call. Is it true, Lord? Is it true that you are thinking of me?
Yes, it's true.
That you love me. It's amazing. I am a friend of God. 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 Not just to be. I'm a friend of God. 'Cause he calls me.
One more time, let's declare it.
I want to be a friend of God. I am a friend. Oh. Yeah. God, you call me friend.
Hallelujah. Can we give an offering, a clap offering to the Lord God Almighty for such a word? Hallelujah. And let us thank the Lord for his servant who has given us that word. Hallelujah. So just appreciate Pastor Phil. Amen. We may take our seats in the presence of the Lord. How God wants us to live a life where we're looking outward. We're looking away from ourselves. We're looking to the world around us so that we can be the hands of God. We would be the hands where God wants to reach you, would use you and I. That is one thing that really jumped out at me. That's my revelation from all of that sermon, that God wants us to live a life where we are thinking of that friend, picking up that call, not expecting the call to come to us, but picking up that call to make the first step, being intentional about friendship. It's something that God really wants us to do, being that shoulder to cry on. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Once again, we thank God for the powerful word. Hallelujah. So what we'll do is we'll just do the administrative side of things, the announcements for the church. And the first announcement goes to our nightly prayers. We have these every night from 11:30 to 12:30 a.m. on Zoom. It's a moment of connecting with God, keeping that altar burning, so that we are always aligned to what God is doing. Amen. And the second announcement concerns the Wednesday Bible studies. These are on Zoom currently, from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. On the church link. But very soon they will be in person on a Sunday, so beginning of next year. They will be in person in church on Sundays. Just be prepared for that. Hallelujah. Time. It will be before the service. It will be before the service. Very good question. We can bring the times on the WhatsApp platform. We can create a flyer and then send it across. There is a flyer already. It will go around, yes. Very good question. Thank you for that. And if you'd like to give towards the church building project, please see Sister Michelle or Pastor Errol for more details. If you don't know Sister Michelle, she's sitting here. See her. If you want to find any more information, please reach out to Sister Michelle about the church building project. Amen. And the hospitality team would like some volunteers. If you are here and you are looking for a place to serve the Lord, that's one place where you can start. The hospitality team, the junior church, the administration team, a few departments are looking for volunteers. So you can see for hospitality, you can see Auntie Jackie, Junior Church, you can see Sister Esther, and for administration, you can see Pastor or Sister Michelle or Sister Vanessa, and the Lord will give you the strength to do whatever you'll be doing in those departments. Amen. Hallelujah. And we have the leaders and team members meeting on Saturday. It's this coming Saturday, and it will be in person in church. It will take place from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. So if you're a leader in any department or if you're a member of any department, please do come along. This will be the last meeting that we'll have for this year. And there'll be many things that we'll need to be informed about and to learn. So please make time for this, and the Lord will do good to us. Amen. And we will have the New Year's Eve service here at the Bridge Church in person. It will be from 9 p.m. to 12:30 a.m. So that will be the New Year's Eve. It will be here. It will be a wonderful time. It's always a wonderful time. Amen. Crossing over into the next year in the presence of the Lord. I can't imagine any other way that you'd want to do it. That's the only way that we should do it. Hallelujah. Invite your friends. Invite your family. It will be an awesome time in the presence of the Lord. And number 7, Foundation Class 101. So this will be starting in January. And we have the dates here, 17, 24, 31st of January. It will be taking place here in the building and starts from 7 p.m. in the evening. Everyone is invited to come to this. You will learn many things. You learn much about God, about the journey into discovering who you are, where you should be ministered, where you should be stepping into as your calling. So this is an invitation to everyone in the church. Hallelujah. Please create some time on the dates that are on the flyer and the Lord will do good to us. Amen. So if you're a first timer, the last announcement, if you're a first timer, there will be tea in the meeting room. You can meet Caris. She just stepped out. Okay. So Caris, if you don't know Caris, you can just see myself or Sister Michelle, Pastor, will direct you to Caris. Hallelujah. And lastly, so Caris turned a number of years recently, and she had a birthday during, so she's brought a cake. So she would like us to collect a piece before we go as we celebrate with her. So yeah, please grab a piece of cake before you go. And I think we can pray for her, yeah. So if we could all, when Caris comes, we could all be on our feet, extend our hands towards Caris and pray for her. Caris is one of the leaders here. She leads the young adults ministry. And she's 25. She's doing amazing for the kingdom of God. And we'd just like to appreciate her. So, Caris, we just come and stand here. We caught you unaware. So we just want to pray. Just to pray. You know, your birthday was a few days ago. So just to say, may God keep you. May God continue to bless you, to enlarge you. So if you don't mind, just extending your hands towards Caris and just pronounce a blessing, speak good things about her.